Hi, it's Mr. Andersen. Welcome to AP Biology Science Practice 3. This is on formulating questions that guide both discussion and further investigations. It used to be if you were a good scientist, it meant that you had a lot of knowledge because there wasn't a lot of knowledge out there available to everyone. It was housed in libraries. And even when I was a little kid, if I wanted to find the answer to a question, I literally had to drive to the library, get a book, and then look it up in the book. But now, since we have data really available at our fingertips, our ability to formulate and ask good questions is super important, especially in the sciences. And I find a transition in my students. Once they really start to get it, they start to ask higher and higher level questions. And if you really don't understand it, sometimes you can't even formulate a good question to ask. And so what kind of questions am I talking about? You should be able to answer questions when I say, how do we know what we know? In other words, I could say, what scientific experiments allow us to know that DNA rather than proteins is the genetic material? And then you should be able to answer, this is how we know what we know. And so I was trying to think about, how do I get students to get better and better at asking questions? When do they do that in their lives? And then it came to me that we constantly do that. Because if you ever type something in Google, you're really asking a question. And so let's look at a few questions and then we'll kind of judge which ones are good and which ones are not so good. So let's say you were to type this in. What's the world's smallest living bird? Well, that's an okay question, and Google's going to give you a quick response. I think it's some form of hummingbird. But it's not a great scientific AP biology question because you quickly get a fact right back to you. It doesn't lead to further discussion or investigation. Or let's try this one. Are we alone in the universe? Well, that's a pretty profound question. If you were to Google that, I would imagine you'd get lots of answers, but none of them are really going to be right. It's an unanswerable question with the technology that we have today. So that's not a great question. What about this one? Are genetically modified foods good or bad? Well, we're adding value at this point. So what does it mean to be good or what does it mean to be bad? And so that's not really a good scientific question as well. Once we started adding value to it, we can't measure that empirically, so it's not a great question. Let's go to another one. What about this? What factors affect plant growth? Well, now we're getting closer. This is really something that we can measure. But since I just said factors in there, there's so many things that could affect plant growth. Number one, what type of plant are we really talking about and how are we measuring that plant growth? And so I could refine that question. What's the optimum carbon dioxide concentration for Brassica rapa growth? And now really I'm paring it down to one independent variable and then one dependent variable. And so we're getting to a good question that could lead to, you know, fact finding, it could lead to future investigations. And so here's a good example of a question that AP suggests. What happens to photosynthesis at very high non-biological temperatures? And so what are we looking at here? We're looking at two things. We've got an independent variable, which is clearly the temperature that we could change, and then we're looking at a dependent variable, which is photosynthesis. And so we do a photosynthesis lab, remember, where we're looking at the leaf chads float, and so we could change the temperature and see how that affects it. Before that, though, we could look at a literature search. We could actually get through some of the scientific journals and see what, you know, has this been done before and what did they find? We could go on a fact-finding mission, Google searches, where we find more information, and it could lead to experimental design. And so a good question is going to lead to further discussion and then further investigation. And they want you to be able to do that in each of the four big ideas. And so here's some examples they give. So let's say we're looking at evolution. If I were to give you a phylogenetic tree, you should be able to ask and answer a bunch of questions based on that. Or what about free energy? You could say, you know, where are the molecules going to move? This looks like facilitated diffusion. Or we could even pose questions about, you know, what happens if I change one of these proteins and the function of a protein. As we get to information, there's lots of questions you could be posed about, you know, genetic problems. So in this pedigree, you could try to determine what the inheritance pattern is. And then we could get even to ethical questions when we're saying, you know, if you know that you have their gene, are you likely to have kids or would you have kids? And then as we get to systems, interacted systems like this is a food web, you could ask questions about, you know, what happens if we change one part of this food web or if we were to decrease the amount of producers, how's that going to affect the consumers? And so you really have to be able to do three things. You have to be able to come up with questions or pose questions. You have to be able to refine those questions, and then you have to be able to evaluate questions that are asked. And you're going to do this on a test, which is asking you questions. And so it's kind of tricky to ask your to judge your questioning ability using questions, but this is kind of how they'll get at it. And so first of all, you have to be able to pose scientific questions. And so if I were to give you this, with it, which is a phylogenetic tree of life, you can see that we have the three domains, eukarya, archaea, and bacteria. Could you come up with three good questions that you could answer either from this tree or from information that you know about this tree? So what are some questions? With each of these, remember, you could pause the video and take a shot at this. Well, I might ask this question right away. Which of these are more related to eukarya? Is it the archaea or the bacteria? That'd be an okay question. Another question might be, what characteristics of archaea and bacteria and eukarya allowed scientists to produce such a tree? And then remember, this implies that we had one last universal common ancestor, that would be right down here. So what are some shared characteristics of that? And so those are pretty good questions, kind of questions at getting how do we know what we know? In other words, how did we come up with a phylogenetic tree like this? Next thing you need to be able to do is refine questions. And so this is a question from a practice test from the AP College Board that gets at this. And so let me kind of talk you through it. Basically, we have figure one up here, which shows algal growth of a species in sterilized pond water over time. So you can see it's increasing then stabilizing. If phosphate is added right here, then we see the following growth. And so we see an increase in algal growth as well. And so the question they're asking is, which of the following would be the best prediction of algal growth if nitrate rather than phosphate is added? And then they give you four tries at this, or four different guesses that you could make. And trust me, when I looked at this question the first time, I missed this question as well. So take a second to lock in your answer. And the right answer is C right here, that nothing should happen when you add nitrate. And so when I thought, I thought this is going to be it right away. And then as I thought about it a little more deeply, I realized what we're looking at here is a limiting nutrient. And so basically what happened is when you added phosphate, that was the one nutrient that these algae were needing. And so they took off. They didn't need nitrate at this point. So if you would have given them nitrate, it wouldn't have helped them. Let me put that in context that might help you. So let's say you're going to the movies. Now, I've changed the question. So through time, this is your ability to go watch a movie. If I were to say I gave you your car keys at point A, we'll say right here, that allowed you to go see the movies. Which of the following would be the best prediction if instead of me giving you car keys, I would have given you additional money? Well, the right answer would be this one, the same one as here, because you really didn't need the money to get to the movies. What you needed was to have your car keys so you could drive to the movies. And so again, we're looking at a question that is then being refined. So they're asking you a question, then you actually have to say, let's take that to another level. And finally, you have to be able to evaluate scientific questions. And so this is Stanley Miller, Miller-Urey's famous experiment. They were attempting to model early Earth conditions. Remember, they put all of the gases and added some energy that kind of simulated what early life on our planet was, and we could make some of the building blocks of life. And so here, in order for them to test your ability to evaluate scientific questions, they're saying which of these are the questions, or was the question that Miller was trying to answer. So you could pause and take a stab at this one. The right answer is C. He was trying to show that the molecules essential to life today could have formed under early Earth conditions. And so this is how they're going to get at your ability to ask questions on the AP exam. But questions are very important. It's almost like dominoes, because if you're good at asking questions, that's going to directly lead to practice four, which is developing experimentation, then data analysis, and then using explanations and theories. And so the next three science practices are built on your ability to ask questions. And so I hope that was helpful.